research, you know, tell us about your thought idea about generative models and adversary essentially.
Bit of an echo. So just one thing I'd just like to say, actually, unfortunately, I didn't quite realize I was supposed to be talking on the vision theme, but so I'm going to be talking about things actually which don't have any vision whatsoever in them, but they are about sort of learning representations of things. So hopefully it's still, you know, relevant to the theme of the workshop. Okay, so the first, I'm going to actually present two different things, both of them with the same authors, my student Sam Bayat at NYU and Arthur Schlamm at Facebook. And so the first one is going to be all to do with a sort of a novel form of kind of self-play. This is actually entirely Sina's idea, I should say. And so I was just really helping him turn it into, you know. Okay, so the motivation really is that in reinforcement learning, you know, sample complexity is an issue, particularly in model-free settings. So you need a huge number of episodes to actually learn anything useful. And also, of course, you know, each of those episodes is going to require some kind of supervisory signal in form of reward from the environment, and that can be expensive to obtain. And so this work is really about trying to learn from the environment in an unsupervised way. So the idea is that, you know, if by just interacting with the environment, you know, can we learn something useful? And this is sort of independent of whatever target task you might want to do later. And the underlying assumption is somehow that this interaction is kind of cheap and something that we can do, you know, essentially zero cost, just so it'll help us, give us a sort of free way to kind of initialize the models for the actual target tasks we care about. And of course, you know, it's a little bit how, you know, kids tend to just interact with the environment and play around with things too. So maybe there's, you know, some analogy on the way humans learn about the world. Okay, so just to summarize the approach, it's pretty simple. The idea is you have a single agent. It's going to be playing a game essentially with itself. So there'll be a single physical agent, but it's going to have two separate minds. So we're going to call them Alice and Bob. And so Alice's job is essentially to propose a task, and then Bob's job is to complete it. Okay, now there's different ways Alice could possibly propose a task, and which she's actually going to do by just sort of executing a sequence of actions. In other words, she's actually going to go ahead and actually do a task. And then there's two scenarios which we're going to look at. So this will depend on the nature of the environment. So if we're in an environment which is reversible, so if we can go return to a you know, if we take an action, we can go back to the state by undoing that action by another action. So if the environment's reversible, then we're going to look at a sort of reverse form of self-play, and I'll describe these more in just a second. And if the other version we're going to look at is where the environment is perhaps resettable, so we can just reset to some initial state or some desired state, and then we're going to look at something called repeat self-play. So these are just two slight variants on the same idea, depending on, you know, the nature of the environment we have. And the idea is that we're going to use these self-play episodes sort of in conjunction with training when we're training the target task. So we'll sort of alternate essentially between, you know, a self-play episode and then a target task episode, just, you know, choosing according to some prior distribution. So, you know, 80% self-play and then say 20% target task or something like that. And the hope is that if the tasks that Alice proposes during this self-play are somewhat, you know, close to the target task, then perhaps, you know, the self-play episodes will essentially help train the model in a useful way for the target task at hand. Okay, so now just to describe the two variants of self-play. So in the reverse form, so Alice is going to start at some initial state, and then she's going to take a sequence of actions, and then at some point when she chooses, she will take a special action, which is not within the environment, which is a sort of stop action, which will then hand control of the physical agent over to Bob. Okay, and then Bob, in the reverse form, his job is to then return the agent back to Alice's initial state. So this initial state over here becomes Bob's target. And of course, he can take different actions. He doesn't have to take the same sequence. He just has to get back to the same state that Alice started at. Okay, now the other variant is this repeat self-play. So instead, now when Alice executes the stop action, we're going to sort of reset the environment to the initial state over here, and then Bob is going to be asked to essentially then just repeat and return now. The target now basically becomes this final state that Alice was in before she executed the stop action. Okay, so depending on the environment, we might be able to use one or two of these, one or the other different versions. Now, the sort of key idea here is to sort of set up the internal reward between Alice and Bob in a way that incentivizes the sort of exploration of the environment so that we sort of learn useful things about the environment. And the reward structure we use, so this, just to be clear here, this is just an internal reward. This doesn't involve any sort of external reward from the environment. So this, the reward structure we have is that we're going to, the reward for Bob will just be minus the amount of time he spent trying to execute the task. And if, we let, if Bob sort of, you know, completely is flailing around and is not getting anywhere, we have a sort of maximum time limit, which after which we sort of assume Bob has failed. So he can't exceed Tmax amount of time. And then for Alice, what we're going to do there is we, she's going to get positive reward for the amount of time Bob spends. So she wants to make things hard for Bob. But she doesn't want to sort of, you know, she also, we have a, also have the amount of time she spends performing the task in there as well. So in other words, you don't want to, if she spends a lot of time doing some immensely complicated task, then she's going to get penalized for it as well. And so intuitively, what we're trying to do here is make Bob fail, but with just a sort of minimal amount of effort. And so her optimal behavior really is to try and find the simplest tasks that Bob can't complete. And this makes learning easy for Bob because essentially, you know, the task he's trying to perform is always going to be just beyond his current capabilities. And this gives us a way to kind of build an automatic curriculum between Alice and Bob. Okay, so this is, so for example, initially Alice might just move, you know, one square to the right, and then Bob's got to repeat, you know, go back, you know, one square to the left. But then, you know, of course, once Bob completes that, Alice has got to make things harder, so she's now got to move, you know, several squares away, and then Bob would have to come back and so on. Okay, and so in practice, what we see, and I'll show you some examples of, you know, Alice will take increasingly sort of complicated trajectories, you know, within the environment, and then Bob will have to then undo them.
Question?
Sure. Yep.
So by learning, I mean, how do you propagate gradients or anything?
Okay, so I'll just come to this all in a second. Okay, so the basic idea is we're going to be using a policy gradient. So we're going to have a sort of parameterized function which will take in, so normally you would have taken the current state and you would output an action. So in our version, we're going to have to take in two states. So for Alice will have, you know, this is her policy function FA. So she will take in the current state at time t, but she also has to, you know, has one of the, as one of the input arguments, the initial state that she was in at the beginning of the episode. And then based on that, we'll output some action. I mean, in practice, you'll have a softmax over possible actions, and then you'll just sample from it. And then Bob, so Bob will take in, again, his, the current state he's in, but he also will take in the target state. So that's the state he's trying to reach. Okay, so both of these will be sort of parameterized functions that we're going to end up learning during self-play. Now, what's going to happen then is that when we want to apply, you know, when we come to the target task, we're basically going to take Bob's policy network and we're going to reuse it. Okay, so now this is now the state of the environment in your test task. And for the second input argument, at the moment we just have a sort of basically essentially a dummy vector that we would, you know, of random, basically a dummy random vector. In practice, we'd like to sort of, you can imagine this being some sort of description of the task in some sort of embedding of natural language or something like that, but we haven't quite got that far with that, with the idea yet. But the basic idea is that, so the idea is that Bob, the knowledge that Bob learns in trying to complete these self-play tasks that are set by Alice is going to be directly used for the target task, okay? And so, right, so the assumption that we're sort of hoping for here is, again, that sort of these self-play tasks that Alice sets are going to be useful for the target at hand. And what we're going to do is we're going to try a bunch of different settings with both discrete and continuous, and we'll just be using sort of small little neural nets for these policy networks. So in practice, so just to send you this question, so in practice we're going to learn the parameters of these policy networks with reinforce. So this is just policy standard policy gradient.
What I'm wondering is the time. I mean, that's not easy to compute, right?
So, no. So, we take discrete, there's sort of discrete time steps, essentially, that we're going to be taking.
I guess I'm not seeing how the gradient will be calculated.
Okay, actually, so I have a slide right at the end. I actually took it out because it was, hold on, let me see if I can just quickly get to it, because I took it out of the main sequence of things, so this is it. Okay. So this is the pseudocode. So the idea is you have some sort of max, you know, one of the parameters is the max amount of time you can let Bob flail around. So you basically have two chunks here. The amount of Alice is, you know, taking actions, and then she executes the stop action, and then you're just simply incrementing, you know, the time for each action that she takes, and then Bob takes over, and then Bob has to basically try and reach the target. She has to make the current state equal to the target state, or, you know, you time out because you reach exceed some threshold. You compute your rewards, and then you use policy gradient to just update the parameters based on the rewards you achieved for that episode.
Does Bob know the time that Alice took?
Yes, that's known. Yes, so Alice certainly needs to know the amount of time that Bob took. And for Bob's reward, you only need to know the amount of time that Bob took.
Oh, that's all.
Yeah. Right. Okay, so, right, so one, so all those sounds are sort of reasonable, I mean, you know, but is there anything sort of stronger we can say on a sort of theoretical angle? Well, so if you make some admittedly quite dramatic simplifying assumptions, like you have a finite number of states, like you have tabular policies and things like that, you can show that Bob, in practice, will learn how to transition between any pair of states as efficiently as possible. Okay, so that's actually quite a nice property to have. And just as this is a sketch of the kind of argument, you basically assume that if you, during self-play, you've reached some kind of equilibrium. So that is that you can't, you know, Alice can't improve her policy without changing Bob's as well, and vice versa. So the idea is that if Bob now fails on a certain task, then Alice is, should be able to propose that task to increase her reward. Okay. So and then, but equally, of course, if Bob must have seen this task. Because they're somehow at equilibrium, right? So he must have seen this task already, and he would have used it to learnt it to increase his reward. So if the two agents, you know, sorry, if Alice and Bob are both at equilibrium, then somehow in this little toy setting in Italy, then Bob must have learnt all the possible tasks, that is, all the possible state transitions that must occur. And by sort of succeeding, what we mean here is sort of completing things in the minimum amount of time. Now, of course, this argument holds in this sort of very limited setting. In practice, of course, it breaks down because you don't have a tabular policy; you have an actual function approximation. The other thing which can happen is also that this Alice, in theory, should propose actions which Bob. There might be tasks that Alice just fails to propose. And what we'll see in practice is this does happen in real problems. So that Alice will just, you know, there were certain tasks that Alice could propose that Bob just. Would fail on, but Alice doesn't somehow see them, so she just never suggests them to Bob. So, yeah, sure.
Is there another hidden assumption that the equilibrium will be reached? I mean, you argued.
That's true. So, that's true, yes. I guess that's right. You're assuming that you do reach some kind of equilibrium, yeah. Okay, so just to talk about related work. So, self-play is an idea that's been around for, you know, absolutely forever, particularly in the sort of, setting of games. Now, I guess the major difference with our thing is that somehow we're using internal reward, whereas most of the sort of self-play, like in backgammon or Go, using sort of external reward for on the target task itself. Another sort of setting where you see this sort of adversarial self, form of with the self-play, you can consider sort of adversarial form of interaction, and then you've got these sort of generative adversarial nets that are all very trendy these days. I suppose if you want to view what we're doing in that light, you could think of Alice being a sort of generator of hard examples and Bob being a discriminator. And then in the reinforcement learning literature, there's a whole sort of swathe of stuff on sort of intrinsic motivation, trying to sort of reward the agent for exploring new states. So just to contrast, so that is related, but ours is actually different in the sense that we're learning here to transition between sort of pairs of states in the environment. And so, for example, Alice may propose the same state many times if Bob is actually struggling to, return to it or go from it, depending on whether you're reverse or reset version of self-play. So the idea is, so it's not quite the same as just rewarding. So we don't really have any actual notion of novelty in this. And then there's actually a recent paper just by Abhinav and colleagues, which is actually, just came out. So this is uses sort of adversarial perturbations of the state. So this is related, but it's slightly different to what we're doing, and so on. I was hoping Abhinav was going to talk about this afternoon, but it seems he's got many other things he's going to speak about. Okay, so just look at the experiment. So we're going to use reinforce algorithms. This is standard sort of policy gradient. We will have a learned baseline, and we'll use a little bit of entropy regularization. So that's really the one sort of hyperparameter in the system. We will have a two-layer neural net for the policy networks for Alice and Bob. So these will actually be different. They will, we're not tying them to be the same. And then when we're training, we're going to do a blend of 80% self-play episodes and 20% target task episodes. Okay, and then we'll look at sort of continuous and discrete environments. And the main sort of metric we're going to use here is reward on the target task versus the number of target task episodes. So the implicit sort of assumption here is that really those self-play episodes are kind of free. So obviously they're not free time-wise, but they're free from the point of view of, from the point of view of the amount of sort of environmental reward that you have to obtain. Okay, so just in terms of the baselines, the obvious thing you can do is just, ditch the self-play and just try using reinforce itself and just training pure on the target task episodes. You can think of some sort of intermediary form. We have a kind of random form of Alice. So Alice just takes random actions, and then Bob tries to learn a policy around that. So obviously, there won't be any sort of sense of a curriculum then. And then we'll also compare to sort of the existing things in the literature, these sort of exploration-based methods that incentivize, you know, visiting new states based on sort of the count of previously visited states and things like that. Yep.
So it would help to maybe ground this in some example, like what is Ellis's goal here?
Okay. Yep. So I've got a super simple example. Okay. So here we have a little one-dimensional corridor, and the agent can go either left or to the right. Okay. And this is so in self-play, what will happen is that Alice will start at some position. She will, you know, take a sequence of actions, and then hand control over to Bob, and Bob's goal will be to take the agent back to where Alice started. Okay, so this is a simple sort of you can do this with a tabular policies for both Alice and Bob. This is the reverse form of self-play because they're trying to get back to the original state. Now, what will happen then is at test time, when you come to the target task, Bob will be given a goal state that he needs to reach, and so he will effectively just have to move from his current location to this one over here. So in this case, the target task and the self-play tasks are really the same thing. So you'd expect it to kind of work in this setting. Okay, so this is just plotting the number of target task episodes here and the success ratio. So if you just do reinforce by itself, you're on the red curve. So it does, you know, pretty well, but doesn't quite completely nail the problem. If you do random Alice, that's the magenta curve. That somehow hurts. If you do the reinforce plus the self-play, which is our algorithm, that's the blue one. But at least on this example, I have to, you know, it's the baseline does actually do about as well. So if you do the count-based methods, this is such a simple problem, which is kind of, you know, almost ideally designed for the count-based approaches, then it does about the same as our approach. Okay, so a slightly harder setting now is one where this thing maze-based. So this is a kind of form of grid world. We have various objects in the world, so it's a 2D grid. We have a wall with a door in it, and there are sort of objects in the world, like a light, which you have to turn on or off, and then a key, which will unlock the door. And the idea is that this is going to be procedurally generated at random for each episode. So you'll have a slight different dimensions of the maze. The wall position will change, the door position will change, and stuff like that. And during self-play, basically Alice and Bob get to sort of play around in this environment. Okay, they get to sort of pick up the key and try and unlock the door and these sorts of things. So you can't go through the door until you pick up the key and so on. So just going to the door is not going to do anything. And then you can turn the light on or off. Now, in the target task, we'll have a scenario where there'll be some new object, which is going to be a goal, which will be on the other side of the door. And then Bob essentially is going to have to learn to sort of turn on the light switch, pick up the key, open the door, and go through. So in the light will be on the other side of the wall in the target tasks. Okay. So in this case, the target and self-play tasks aren't exactly the same. There's some differences between them. So if we look at the results for that, so this is essentially, again, the number of target task episodes on the x-axis, and this is the reward, so high is good. So you can see just training with reinforce on the target task, eventually you get somewhere, but it takes you a long time. If you train with the self-play, this is the green curve, then you actually come up very, very quickly, and that's much faster than the random Alice variant. There's also a sort of wrinkle that, you know, the sort of distance in some sense, or the similarity between the target task and the self-play task. As that changes, you'll see the different methods of self-play kind of, you know, being more or less useful. So at least in this scenario, that the two variants here differ somewhat in their robustness to that distance. So in this case, the repeat method seems to be more reliable.
You don't have Reinforced Explorer on this chart?
No, we do not on this one. I think it's, yes, we don't. We have it on some of the other the ones coming up.
During train time, do you consistently explore all the different tasks available?
So I'll plot that at the end. So the answer is no. So that's actually, I think, the clear shortcoming of the thing, which we'll look at the end. So what you see is, in fact, this is, I guess, what I'm saying later. Well, actually, let me just save it for later on, just in the interest of time. But I do have a slide directly on that point. Okay, so this is just a visualization here of the curriculum being learnt by that Alice is setting for Bob. So essentially, what we're looking at here are the different numbers of objects that Alice interacts with during her self-play episode, okay? And this is sort of as we continue the self-play training. Now, initially, Alice doesn't really interact with any objects, but after a while, you know, pretty quickly, she starts to learn how to interact with a single object in the environment. But that then drops after a while, because you can see now that basically Bob is figuring out how to, you know, solve those little tasks. So now she has to involve ones that use two objects and finally sort of three objects, okay? And then you can see that if you just have a random Alice, then, you know, by chance you might bumble into one object, but you're never really going to get two or three. And you can, so this, you know, this is, the scale is different on these two plots. Okay, so this is showing you that you're building up some kind of sort of automatic curriculum between Alice and Bob. And this is just showing you the sort of internal reward between the two of them. So you can see that they're sort of complementary to one another. And then one thing you'd of course expect to see is that as if you're going to set hard, if Alice is setting harder tasks, she should be taking longer to do. She's got to do more complicated trajectories to to get to these all the objects in the environment. So and you do see that. So as training goes on, you see that the number of time steps Alice takes does increase, and so on. Now bear in mind, of course, she gets penalized for taking in her reward. She gets penalized for taking more time. So the fact she's doing this is meaning that Bob must be solving the easy. Yep. Right. So there's no. It's that. Right. So that's a great question. So that's a bit sort of like in domain transfer. How do you measure the difference between source and target domains? So it's hard to sort of quantify this exactly. It's true. You can sort of give some sort of hand wavy thing. I do have a slide at the end, perhaps I can talk about where we did try to systematically. There's a parameter we can use when we construct the maze based environment that will change the distance between the two of them, but it's hard to sort of quantify this in any way. I mean, you can see that it does make a difference to the algorithm's performance. Yep.
I wanted to ask, so Alice is doing essentially a different task than Bob.
That's right.
Her policy is both choosing the task and performing, right?
Right, that's right. So yes, that's true.
Well,
that's why we call it, the title sort of asymmetric self-play a little bit, because yes, exactly, because the two people are doing slightly different things. So the RL Lab is one of these sort of environments in the sort of OpenAI or Majoco. It's one of these sort of common sort of benchmark applications. The idea is you've got this is a continuous problem actually, where you have a car in a valley and it's trying to escape from the valley and it can't do it by just driving up. It has to sort of go back and forth, building up momentum, and then eventually it gets enough momentum to kind of escape. And the target task, it only gets reward if it actually exits on one of the hillsides. And it's difficult because somehow just random exploration here is not going to succeed. Just randomly trying left and right actions means you'll just sit at the bottom of this the hill, kind of going back and forth. Now, the environment is actually very asymmetric in the sense that it's much easier for the car to kind of descend the hill than it is to go up. So in practice, for this one, we use the repeat form of self-play rather than the reverse. And so this is a comparison here to some of the sort of leading approaches. So they tend to use TRPO. This is a trust region form of policy optimization. It's a lot more complicated than reinforce. So they use that plus. This is a hashing-based exploration thing where you kind of hash existing states you've been to. And this is Vime, which builds some little sort of density model of things. So those are the two existing approaches. And this is R1 with the reinforce plus self-play is in blue. So it does about as well, at least on this task, as the other two. If you just try reinforce by itself, it completely flatlines. You can't get anywhere at all on the problem.
So I'm clear what Alice knows. I mean, how is Alice being programmed, for instance, in this setting?
And so Alice doesn't sort of know anything initially. Okay. So initially, she'll just do something very dumb, like just move the car slightly to the left or something like that. Okay. Right? And then Bob, in this, given that we're doing the repeat self-play, Bob's task will be he's got to get back to the same state. So that is the same position and velocity. So it's a two-dimensional state in this little problem. So Bob will have to then take actions to move to the same position and velocity that Alice set. But then, of course, once Bob does that, the reward that Alice receives will kind of be small. So then what has to happen is Alice has to devise something a little bit more complicated. So she might have to go back and forth a few times, now to get, say, up on, halfway up the hill. And then Bob would have to figure out how to get up there. And he wouldn't be able to do it just by kind of directly going up. He'd also have to use the same mechanism.
But I guess I'm not seeing why that helps Alice to see Bob struggling.
Because if the longer takes Bob, the more struggle, Alice gets positive reward if Bob struggles. So Alice wants Bob to fail, but only in the sort of the short, she needs to take the fewest actions she can to get Bob to fail. So it was the reward.
But is there an intuition why that helps? I mean, so Alice doesn't know either what to do, right?
No, she doesn't, but at the same time, she knows that she needs to be able to find things. They have the same capacity, the two models, and she has to find stuff to do that Bob is going to struggle with, and that if she starts off doing some insanely complicated thing where she runs all the way over the other side of the environment, then yes, Bob will fail, so he'll get T max will be here, but then this term here will also be pretty large. Right, so Alice initially doesn't want to do anything too crazy. She wants to do things just beyond what Bob can actually achieve herself, is able to achieve, right? And then, of course, if Bob now solves it, then these two quantities will be the same, right? So then Alice's reward will basically be now zero. So she now has to come up with a slightly harder problem where Bob will now spend longer trying to solve it than Alice did setting it in the first place.
But what's your intuition, like even in that Bali case? Why does that
faster? Right, so the thing is, so let's just look at that for example. So for example, to solve this problem, you need to sort of learn how to sort of get up the sides. If you just take random actions, you'll just vibrate basically at the bottom. So if Alice is setting an objective to get sort of part way up the wall, that's directly useful for sort of the target task. All right, so the idea is that what will have to happen is that Bob, in learning how to repeat Alice's feat of getting halfway up the wall, will have in practice sort of be given a sort of partial, you know, solution to the actual target task that you care about.
So one thing that's confusing here is Alice is no smarter than Bob, right?
That's correct.
So yeah. Alice somehow, just by doing something, just is ahead of Bob, right? But just some random thing or whatever. Right? Alice is not smarter than Bob.
That's right. So, right. So, I mean, in the sense that she gets to choose what the problem is ahead of time, right? So then, Bob, it's not clear that. So that's the other thing, actually. So, given that we're training together those two, the target task and the self play, there is some effect where the Bob's policy is getting gradients both from the self play episode and from the target task episode. Okay, so that he is being sort of dragged, as it were. If he's got limited capacity, some of his capacity is going to have to be sort of used to try and work on the target task. And so in some sense, Alice does have an edge over him that way. All right, so that all Alice is trying to do is fool Bob. Whereas Bob's got to, you know, solve the task Alice set and do okay on the target task.
So is the target task being done at the end of all the self-play, or is it being done interleaved?
No, it's interleaved. You interleave randomly during training episodes. So we did try both, actually. It does help to interleave,
Does Bob see the sequence of actions?
No. He just sees the end state.
If you do something like Rubik's Cube in reverse self-play, basically Alice is doing the same.
Yes, that's right. Yes, exactly. Yeah.
So it seems that the examples you are using here are mostly the kind of questions where you move from states to states.
That's right.
Is it true that this contact technique is mostly help this kind of situation? Because it's kind of like easier for Alice to come up with a new problem, which is similar to the target.
Right. So of course, yes. That's right. So of course, states, by transition between states, it doesn't necessarily mean position necessarily. You could have states that involve some, you know, property of the agent, whether it's picked up an object or something like that. It's supposed to be, if you assume that your state representation is sort of complete, that, you know, then I guess this in theory should be useful. But there's definitely this issue of like, I'll show you perhaps at the end, because we're talking about this, just a situation where if you make the self-play task deliberately different to the test, the target task, it does stop the thing working, essentially, which is not that surprising. Okay, so the final one I wanted to talk about was this task is called Swimmer Gather. The basic idea is you have a little worm, it's hard to see, sorry, on this figure. Basically, it's got two joints, and you have you can control each time step, you can control the torque on those two joints. So basically, and it's embedded within a viscous fluid, so the idea is it's swimming around. And at the test for the target task, what's going to happen is that the little worm needs to gobble up the green blobs and get a +1 reward, and then you have -1 reward if you gobble up one of the red blobs. Okay, so this is, we're going to use the reverse form of self-play that here, just to be clear, in the self-play, the worm is just in the fluid and he gets to swim around. In the target task, then there'll be the green and red blobs that he has to avoid or eat, respectively. Okay. Now, so that's the basic setup. So this is again comparing to these existing baselines. So this is TRPO and the various other things. So those, it's quite a hard problem because obviously to swim anywhere, you have to actually coordinate over sort of many time steps to get the thing swimming in a kind of in a useful way to make headway in the goop that it's swimming in. Okay. So again, if you try the just reinforce on this, you completely get nothing works at all. If you put in the self-play, though, it actually works quite nicely. And here we're sort of at this problem, which is, I think, harder than the other ones. We are actually solving quite a bit better in terms of the target task reward than the thing. And it also learns faster, too, which is nice. So just to show you some little these are little movies of the actual thing. So there's the worm is sort of, this is the train model, and you can see it's swimming towards that green blob, and it's going to pick things up. Now, one thing you'll notice is that the worm is kind of swimming. These are different target task episodes, you know, with the trained network. You'll notice the worm is more or less swimming sort of in the same direction. And that brings us back to the point I was making earlier, that Alice doesn't always, you know, uniformly propose tasks, right? She's basically, what happens is she finds one particular task that Bob struggles with, and she keeps basically sort of giving that to him. And so if you look at a sort of scatter plot here, you know, different phases of training where Alice hands over to Bob. So what you'd like to see is a sort of, you know, wide cloud here of different locations in the environment. In practice, what you see is that somehow, you know, it often ends up concentrating in a single point, okay? Because there's a sort of single position that Alice finds, you know, consistently sort of Bob seems to struggle with. And that sort of brings us to, yeah, basically this. So that's, I think, one of the big issues with the method. You'd like to have some sort of meta exploration where you perhaps have multiple Alices, because basically at the moment what happens is Alice can often focus on the single best task that really, you know, consistently deceives Bob. Okay, but anyway, this is a kind of simple method that works quite well on both discrete and continuous environments, the ones we tried. And we're trying on more complicated things right now to see whether we can still, whether it works there too. And then in the future, I mean, the obvious things, other things we could try, you can imagine interesting ways to communicate the task instead of Alice actually, you know, performing a sequence of actions. You can imagine she communicates it through some, some embedded version of natural language or something like that. Or maybe, you know, Alice can propose some sort of simple hypothesis about the environment, and then Bob has to go and test it, and things like that. Okay, so actually we're about, are we over time? What's the time?
We have 5 minutes. Yeah.
5 minutes, okay, well actually, you know what, I'm gonna ditch the second half of my talk. And I just come back to the point that somebody was asking about to do with the similarity between, so one thing we can do is, in that MaySpace environment, sorry, let me just get the slide back up for a second. So in this environment, one thing we can do is when we're procedurally generating this, randomize the initial state. So we can pick the initial state of this light, okay? Now, during self-play. So maybe the light's on initially, maybe it's off initially. Now, in the target task, this light will always be off initially. So, and the catch is that the way the environment's set up is you can't see other objects in the environment if the light's off. You can only see the sort of glowing light itself. So in the target task, Bob has to go over to the light, turn it on, then he can see where the key is, and then he can go to the door and solve the goal. So by varying this probability of the light being on during the self-play episodes, we can actually sort of control how similar the self-play and target tasks are. So if this light is on initially, then Bob doesn't actually have to bother turning it on. You know, he can just go directly and get the key and go through the door and stuff. So the problem is that if the light's consistently on during self-play, but then off during the self-play tasks, you know, you're sort of changing in some sense the way that that Bob will interact with the environment. And you can, sure enough, you kind of see this. Okay, so this is changing this prior probability of the light being off. So between 0.1 and 0.9, and you can see the different forms here, the different forms of self-play. Sorry, let me back up. This axis is the speed up over just training on the target task alone. So if the self-play didn't confer any advantage, you'd be at the black dashed line. Okay, and sure enough, you see that sort of the random Alice idea gives you is basically more or less at the black dashed line. Now, if for the reverse and repeat forms of self-play, because they have sort of opposite ways of operating on the environment, the default behavior for these is the opposite direction. So for example, the repeat self-play, that prefers, you know, if the light's off consistently, then this means basically that it will encounter during self-play the light switch in a similar way to be encountered at the target task. Okay, but if you drop this, then at some point the self-play task becomes different in the sense the light switch is always going to be on, whereas it would be off for the test task. So this is where you see the drop off there, but the polarity is kind of flipped. So if it's the other way around for the reverse form. So for the reverse form in red, the ordering is kind of flipped. So I guess the point being is that the fact that you see the drop off here is telling you that at some point if the self-play task is too different from the target, the thing doesn't work as well. Okay, and what you'd like to see is, of course, this thing being robust. So you can see that at least for whatever reason, the repeat one seems a little bit more robust in the sense that you can get down to like, you know, 0.4 or 0.3 here and still actually get some reasonable performance gain. Okay, so of course, it's very difficult to sort of, how do you measure the difference between, you know, two different types of problem? I mean, this is a sort of difficult thing to quantify. But this is some sort of hand-wavy thing showing that at least, I mean, it shows the behavior you'd expect, and there is some level of robustness that the thing can tolerate some deviation from between the target and self-play tasks. Okay. So maybe I should just kind of stop there. I mean, I have other stuff, but I think if we're...
am I supposed to finish 10 tasks, is that right?
I'm not sure, is there a particular reason not to have, so your goal is to do some target task. Mm-hmm. Is there a reason not to have Alice, instead of being kind of, you know, randomly adversarial to Bob, know the target task, have some explicit goal of getting Bob to accomplish that target in as short time frame as possible?
So what we're trying to do is minimize the amount of sort of reward from the environment that we use. Okay, so you're assuming that that's expensive. So if Alice has knowledge of the target task, in practice, I mean, the way you... I mean, she has to have some access to the sort of environmental reward function. Otherwise, I mean, it's hard to sort of. I mean, if you already.
Bob presumably does. Or Bob doesn't.
No. Neither Alice or Bob use the reward from the environment at all. It's purely internal. That's the whole point, right? That the you're only going to use the reward from the environment when you're training on a target task episode. Okay, so.
So when Bob is given a target task, he doesn't know that.
I mean, he will only be able to get reward from the environment during a target task episode. During self-play, he will just only get a reward from this internal self-play business. So that's the idea that you want to. These self-play episodes are kind of free. They're just Alice and Bob messing around with the agent, and then once the agent, it doesn't cost anything in terms. You don't have to ever access the reward from the environment during that time.
So I assume that the choice of the reward function would affect like the time that it takes for like reaching the reward.
Right.
Did you try?
Yeah, that's a good question. So we did try one or two things, but I think we were sort of trying to find a simplest thing that would actually do something. And so I think it's a fairly simple reward structure that we've come up with between the two. But you could imagine, it's not a unique thing. There are definitely other options. And it would be interesting to try and understand, as you say, convergence of the two things and stuff like that.
How would you adapt to environments where there's some randomness and you don't know what's under the agent's control?
I see. So if you take the left action, you won't always go left, you mean, and you might go up on instead. Is that?
Also, in the entire game, maybe there's other pixels representing other things on this.
Oh, I see. You mean there are other agents behaving in other ways you can't control and stuff like that. That will sort of be baked in, right? Because if Alice, let's say you have Frogger where you want to cross the road and you have these other cars coming along that might squash you. I mean, Alice's curriculum will be to initially cross one lane and then hand control over to Bob and he has to dart back to the road or something like that, right? So, I mean, it will be implicitly learned by the policy networks of Bob and Alice, if you have these other agents acting in the world. If they're autonomous, if they're part of the, basically they're part of the environment. If they're part of the environment, then this whole thing should do something useful. But it's true, if you have a true multi-agent setting where you have five different agents you have to control, we have a single physical agent. We're not talking about multiple physical agents in this world.
Ideally you want Alice to explore the entire space, but you often see some convergence happen on certain states.
Yep.
So do you tend to converge the same sort of hard states again and again?
Yeah, that's a good question. Not every time you run it, no. So it'll tend to be a different, you're using a different random initialization for the policy networks, right, of Alice and Bob. So there'll be some different thing that Bob finds particularly tricky.
What do you get out of the adversarial structure? So can't you just have one agent exploring the space and being rewarded for seeing new things?
Well, so that's what the baselines are. That's essentially the exploration things. Well, they have some incentive for visiting new states you didn't see before.
What
What's the intuition about why that adversarial structure performs better?
Yeah, so I think it is slightly different in the sense that you're learning to sort of transition between pairs of states. So you're given, you know, between A and B rather than just visiting A kind of for the first time. So so that would be, I think that is a slightly harder thing. I mean, it's a more sort of complete, perhaps, understanding of the environment. If you know how to go between every pair of states, then perhaps just being able to, you know, having visited each state at least once. And that would be this sort of hand-wavy thing, yeah. Alyosha, yeah.
I think this is really, really cool Kristen. Stuff. I was wondering, you mentioned a little bit about what happens if you don't, instead of interleaving, if you actually just do the self-play first, kind of an unsupervised thing, and then test it. So, You said it didn't work as well. Can you explain on this?
Yeah.
Does it saturate?
Well, I think what happens is that Bob focuses solely then on trying to solve the problems for Alice, right? And he doesn't really he gets too specialized on the self play task,
and then self play is in a way unbounded. Why would it saturate? You can keep playing forever. Or is it the environment that's gonna?
You're right. I mean, I think that, but with a sort of finite number, for the same number of episodes anyway, you're going to, you know, if Bob has some knowledge of the problem he's actually trying to solve, then it's going to help a bit, right? No, I understand what you're saying. If you play forever, then you'd assume he would have visited, seen all possible things, and then he should be able to work just fine on the target task. But, I mean, I should ask Sino exactly.
Okay,
so maybe I should.
Yeah, so there'll be a coffee break in 40 minutes, so thank you very much.